In 1947, Joey Lomangino lost his sight and sense of smell in a freak accident that severed his optic and olfactory nerves. After a long and painful period of readjustment, he emerged in 1961 as a successful businessman, but greatly tired from overwork. His doctor suggested that he take a European vacation. So he left his home in Lindenhurst, New York, with relatives, to visit his uncle in southern Italy. Joey was not very religious at the time, and due only to his uncle's persistence, did he consent to a long automobile ride that ended in San Giovanni Rotondo, where the stigmatist Padre Pio lived.
This Franciscan friar, with the wounds of Christ in his hands, feet, and side, was revered as a living saint. But Joey didn't anticipate any personal encounter. After the Mass was over, he found himself in a room with some other men to receive the Padre's blessing as he passed by.
As Father Pio came into the room, we all knelt down and received his blessing. And Father Pio was coming from the left-hand side of the room across the front. And all of a sudden I heard the moving of knees and all, and I didn't know what was going on. And Father Pio had his arms around me, and he started to kiss me on the forehead, and he said, Joey, he said, I'm so happy to see you. And my uncle told me that it was Father Pio embracing me, and I was at a loss for words because I was almost the last one up there, and nobody knew I was going. Not even myself, I knew I was going to Father Pio.
Joey was deeply impressed, and 2 years later returned to San Giovanni. This time he decided to go to confession to Padre Pio.
I went into Father Pio, into the confessional, and I knelt down on the kneeling bench, and Father Pio was sitting right in front of me. And he took me by the hand like that, and I was shocked, because I thought of the American confessional, you know, with the panel, see? So when I knelt down and Father Pio had me by the hand, he told me in Italian, he says, Joey, confess yourself. And to be very honest with you, I was embarrassed because I wasn't leading the right life. And I was just flabbergasted. I didn't know just what to say. So Father Pio took me by the hand like that, and he tells me in Italian, he says, confess yourself. And again, I just found it very difficult to speak to him. And then in perfect English, he said to me, Joey, he says, do you remember when you were in a bar with a woman named Barbara? Do you remember the sins you committed? Then in perfect English, he went right down the line and telling me the people I was with, the places I was at, and the sins I committed. And of course, I was perspiring, and but I had the grace by God to realize that if I had to endure all of that to get back to being happy, it was worth it. And I really believed that Father Pio could help me. So, of course, when he came to the bottom of all my sins, and it felt to me like 1,000 years, he said to me in Italian, he says, are you sorry? And I says, yes, I am, Father Pio. He gave me absolution for my sins. My eyes started to roll in my head. I started to rub my eyes like this, and my head was going around. I kept rubbing my eyes, and my head kept going around. And then all of a sudden, my mind became very, very clear. And he put up a stigmata hand like this to my lips. I kissed the stigmata, and then he gave me a little smack in the face. And he tells me in Italian, Joey, a little patience and a little courage, and you're going to be all right. I was 33 years old, and I felt like I was 16. I had a firm purpose of amendment. I was sorry for all the sins I committed in my life. And I felt so good and so clean that I just didn't want to get involved with anybody because I was afraid by talking, I was going to lose the grace that I received.
But there was still another grace in store for Joey as he again knelt with the other men to receive Padre Pio's blessing.
When I had my injury up here in 1947, I lost my sense of smell. And this has been all stitched up, and this is a 3-inch fracture across the top. I not only lost my eyes, but I lost my sense of smell. So when I knelt down, to receive Father Pio's blessing, I got the fragrance of rose that comes from the blood in his hands. And when I got that fragrance, I was startled, and I went against the wall, my arms up like this to protect myself. I didn't know what it was. So Father Pio pulled down my hand, and he told me in Italian, "Joey, don't be afraid," and he touched me like this at the bridge of my nose, and my sense of smell was restored to me after being without it from the day of my accident in June 1947, which was 16 years.
Joey was overwhelmed with peace and joy and did not want to leave San Giovanni. However, his traveling companion reminded him of their prearranged agreement to spend part of their vacation in a place called Garabandal.
When Mario reminded me that we have to leave and go to Garabandal, I said, "Mario, how do we know it's true? Maybe it's not a true apparition, and maybe it's a trick of the devil to make me lose the graces that I just received." I says, "Let's go ask Father Pio." So he said, "Okay." So, of course, we were always given wonderful, wonderful reception by the priest at Father Pio's. And we went to him, we said, "I'd like to speak to Father Pio, is that okay?" He said, "Oh, yes, Joe." So he made arrangements, and we came back again that day, and we greeted Father Pio in the cloister. When I knelt down, I said to Father Pio, "Father Pio, is it true that the Virgin is appearing to the four girls of Garabandal?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Father Pio, should I go there?" He said, "Yes, why not?" And that's how it happened. Because I received the assurance from Father Pio that the Virgin was appearing and that he permitted me to go, then I wasn't afraid, and I went.
February 1963 would mark the first of many visits to Garabandal for Joey Lomangino. In those days, especially during the winter months, one of the only ways to get up to the village over the winding mountain road was by ox cart. Joey was not long in the village before he met the children to whom the Virgin had appeared. He was immediately impressed by their simplicity and sincerity. Conchita was to become his close friend. Joey was also impressed by the message and the need to make it known, but felt handicapped by his affliction.
I said to myself, "What can I do to make the knowledge of Father Pio and Garabandal better known in the world? What can I do? What can a blind guy do? I was never even in a school play. That's how shy I was."
Joey returned home. He had a scrapbook made up of pictures of Padre Pio and the Garabandal girls in ecstasy, with captions underneath in Braille. He then went around to the homes of friends and relatives, explaining about the famed stigmatist and the remarkable happenings taking place in Garabandal. From this small seed would grow a worldwide apostolate. The year is 1961. The place, a little village in the Cantabrian mountains of northern Spain, called San Sebastian de Garabandal. 300 people live here in some 80 stone dwellings at the base of a small mountain. This village is totally isolated from others in the region and is quite primitive. The homes have no running water or heat, except that coming from the kitchen hearth. Electricity is available for only a few hours each evening. Modern conveniences, such as cars or television, simply do not exist here. In fact, there isn't a motor in the entire village. The people manage to eke out a living by raising livestock, and must walk for more than an hour to reach their pasture lands located higher up in the mountains. All the family members participate in the farm work that consists mostly in harvesting grass that is used as fodder for the animals during the harsh winter times. Although Garabandal is the poorest village in the area, it is also the most religious. Each day, one of the women goes through the streets ringing a bell to remind the villagers to pray for the dead. Every evening, the townsfolk gather in the little village church to pray the rosary and litany of the Blessed Virgin Mary. On weekends, the parish priest from Cosillo makes the rough climb on horseback to celebrate Mass and hear confessions. This was Garabandal in 1961. It was just a simple Cantabrian hamlet that had remained unchanged for decades, maybe centuries. And as the local wisdom had it, it would probably always stay the same. These four girls were typical of those in the village. They lived happily in their mountain setting. Conchita Gonzalez, age 12, Mary Cruz Gonzalez, 11, Jacinta Gonzalez, 12, and Mary Loli Mizong, also 12. Although three of the girls have the same last name, none are closely related. It was still light in the early evening of June 18th, 1961, when the four girls decided to have a bit of fun by taking some apples from the schoolmaster's tree on the outskirts of the village. With giggles of delight, they snatched the apples and took refuge in a rocky cow path that led up to a grove of pine trees on a bluff overlooking the village. As they sat there enjoying themselves eating the apples, they suddenly heard a sound like thunder. And began to feel bad about taking the apples. Suddenly, Conchita's head snapped back, with her eyes staring upwards. The others, seeing her like that, started to scream and were about to run and tell her mother when the same thing happened to them. An angel, in a brilliant light, stood before them. He looked like a 9-year-old boy, but at the same time seemed to be endowed with invincible strength. In a flash, he was gone, and the girls returned to normal. Shaken by the experience, they ran to the village church. A friend saw them and asked why they were so pale. "It's because we've just seen an angel," they replied. Soon the whole town was buzzing about it, although hardly anyone believed the girls really saw an angel. Over the next several days, the girls saw the angel again, and then on July 1st, he spoke. "Do you know why I have come? It is to announce to you that tomorrow, the Blessed Virgin Mary will appear to you as Our Lady of Mount Carmel." By now, news of the apparitions had spread to the surrounding districts. And on July 2nd, a large crowd awaited the girls' anticipated vision of the Virgin Mary. At about 6 in the evening, the girls were on their way to the usual place of the apparitions, when they suddenly fell to their knees on the rocks. In a brilliant light, they saw a beautiful lady standing between two angels. One of the angels they recognized as the one they had been seeing. Later they learned it was none other than Saint Michael the Archangel. Without the slightest fear, the girls spoke with the lady of their vision. They spoke about their families, the priests who were there, and the work they did at home or in the fields. And the lady smiled. Conchita said it was as if they were talking to their mother, who had been away on a trip and had just come back. After the ecstasy, people naturally wanted to know what the lady looked like. In her diary, Conchita gives this description. "The Blessed Virgin appears with a white dress, a blue mantle, and a crown of small golden stars. Her feet are not visible. Her hands are wide open, with a scapular on the right wrist. The scapular is brown. Her hair is long, dark brown and wavy, and parted in the center. She has an oval-shaped face, and her nose is long and delicate. Her mouth is very pretty, with rather full lips. The color of her face is dark, but lighter than that of the angel. It's different. Her voice is very lovely, a very unusual voice that I can't describe. There is no woman that resembles the Blessed Virgin in her voice or in anything else. But there was a purpose behind the Blessed Virgin's appearances to the four girls. She wanted to use these simple, unpretentious children to deliver an important message for all mankind. But being the gentle and loving mother that she is, she would do it in her own way. On her second visit, she came with her child, and the young girls were filled with joy when they saw the smiling infant. In these first apparitions, the girls were seen holding up small stones. They said the Virgin kissed them, but added that she preferred to kiss religious objects. The people responded by giving them their rosaries, medals, crucifixes, and wedding rings, a practice that would continue throughout the events. On July 4th, Mary revealed her message to the girls, but told them not to announce it until October 18th. The truth of the visions first had to be established, so the message would be believed. Proof was needed, and proof was to be provided in abundance. Doctors tested the girls in their ecstatic state. They found them rigid, cold as stone, and insensitive to pain. They also experienced an incredible weight change. Two men could barely lift one girl from the ground, while the girls lifted each other easily so they could kiss the lady of their visions. The girls knew when they were going to see the apparition by a series of three interior calls that got progressively stronger. After the last call, they ran off, filled with joy, to their heavenly rendezvous. The calls came at all hours of the day or night, but if the girls went to bed, then the Virgin would not come. Conchita had to stay up late many nights, awaiting the Virgin's final call. Toward the end of July, the tempo of the visions increased to two or more in a single day, with each ecstasy lasting anywhere from 10 minutes to several hours. The girls' faces became transformed with an unearthly beauty. Some observers were so affected that they had difficulty looking at them. August began with new phenomena. As the girls knelt in ecstasy, they could at any time suddenly flop over backwards until their heads were touching the ground. Sometimes they fell in perfect unison, forming beautiful sculptures. But their clothing was never immodestly ruffled or unbecoming. At other times, they fell straight over backwards, hitting the floor with a thud to the horror of onlookers. But they were never hurt and would get up without the support of their hands or arms. They began walking in ecstasy, either frontwards or backwards throughout the village, with their eyes fixed above the whole time. Notice how Mary Lowly's foot carefully avoids a protruding stone. Sometimes they moved so fast that not even the young men of the village, running at full speed, could keep up with them. Afterwards, they were neither tired nor perspiring, and their pulse rates were normal. During these ecstatic flights, they were able to come to a dead stop, defying the laws of physics. Whereas those trying to keep up, carried by momentum, went running right past them. The girls always carried crucifixes in their hands, which they offered to the bystanders for veneration. They never knew who was kissing the crucifix, because in ecstasy, they couldn't see anyone except their vision and themselves. At the Virgin's command, they would hold out the crucifix to whoever Mary wanted to kiss it. After one ecstasy, Conchita learned that everyone who had kissed the crucifix was a priest dressed in civilian clothes. Among the many priests who went up to Garabandal to study the events was Father Luis Andreo, a Jesuit. He was a brilliant young theology professor who also had the reputation for being a saintly priest. Father Andreo was skeptical on his first visit, but after closely studying the girls in ecstasy, he realized something serious was happening to them. On August 8, 1961, Father Andreo made another visit to the village. That night, he was among the crowd observing the girls in ecstasy at the pine grove where the visions often took place. Suddenly, his face became tense. Beads of perspiration formed on his brow, and he cried out,
"Milagro! Milagro! Milagro! Milagro!"
On the drive home with friends, during the early hours of the next morning, he said, "What a gift the Virgin has given me. How lucky we are to have a mother like that in heaven. This is the happiest day of my life." He then made a slight coughing sound. His head fell to his chest. Father Andreo was dead. In a later vision, the Blessed Virgin told the girls that on August 8th, Father Andreo had not only seen her, but he saw a vision of the great future miracle as well. One of the places the girls in ecstasy visited most often was the village church, where they entered and prayed before the tabernacle. Unfortunately, this created problems. The crowds that followed them inside the church made such a disturbance that a diocesan ban had to be imposed, and the church doors were locked. From then on, they made their visits from outside the closed doors. As an example of obedience to the bishop, Mary no longer led the girls inside. By the beginning of October 1961, the raptures of the four girls had everyone mystified. And once they were caught up in ecstasy, nothing could bring them out of it. They were pinched, pricked with pins, burned with the tips of hot matches, and had sand poured in their eyes, all without effect. Powerful camera flashes, fired from just a few feet away, didn't make them blink. They moved with speed and precision in their frontward and backward marches, without ever looking where they were going. Especially impressive were the nocturnal backward descents down the steep incline from the pines to the village at breakneck speed. Thousands of times, the girls returned religious articles to the right owners without ever making a mistake. And they did this without looking at either the object or the person. These objects were usually piled on a table in one of the girls' homes when they weren't there. Sometimes, the rosaries and medals with chains got all tangled together. But that presented no problem. The girl in ecstasy would take the objects from the table and hold them up to her vision. They separated easily in her hands. Then she would take the object, kissed by Mary, and with her eyes fixed on her vision the whole time, make her way through the crowd until the owner was found. It was a moving experience for a person to have their rosary, medal, or wedding ring come back to them in this mysterious way. Many wept, some fainted. While in ecstasy, the girls prayed as never before. Let's listen to an original taped recording of two girls saying the Hail Mary while actually looking at the person to whom this ancient prayer is directed.
Santa María, Madre de Dios, ruega por nosotros pecadores, ahora y en la hora de nuestra muerte. Amén.
They sang hymns they had not learned, and with the help of Mary, made up charming little couplets. O little Virgin of Carmel, what joy thou hast given us, showing thyself to us with your babe so beautiful. October 18th finally arrived, the day the girls were to announce the long-awaited message from the Blessed Virgin. It was a day of apocalyptic overtones, with thunder and lightning, cold and rain. Nonetheless, hundreds of people made the sacrifice to be there on this all-important day. Time wore on. Many left. Finally, the message was read aloud at the Pines to the crowd that still remained. We must make many sacrifices, perform much penance, and visit the Blessed Sacrament frequently. But first, we must lead good lives. If we do not, a chastisement will befall us. The cup is already filling up, and if we do not change, a very great chastisement will come upon us. Many came away disappointed, having expected more, but that was the message, short and to the point. The most loving of mothers had just told her children in plain and simple language what they must do to avoid a punishment from God that would far surpass anything man could bring upon himself. The ecstasies of the four girls continued into the winter months. At all hours of the night, regardless of weather conditions, the calls came. The Blessed Virgin was deadly serious about the penance and sacrifice she asked for in her message. But once the girls were in ecstasy, they felt nothing. In one heavy snowstorm, ridges of snow formed on Conchita's outstretched arms. She was not aware of it. Another time, she was unaffected by hailstones that bounced off her wide-open eyes. Through the spring and into the summer of 1962, the visits of the Blessed Virgin and Saint Michael continued. If there wasn't a priest available in the village to give the girls communion, Saint Michael brought them invisible communion. He taught them how to receive with reverence. Preparation came first, then communion, and finally thanksgiving. But priests were skeptical about these invisible communions. How could they receive communion from an angel when only a priest had the power to consecrate? The girls asked the Blessed Virgin. She told them the angel took the host from tabernacles on earth. There wasn't a place on earth that remotely compared with Garabandal at this time. The Blessed Virgin seemed to take possession of the entire village. She led the girls in ecstasy down every street. Sometimes they sang the rosary as they marched along, with the people joining in. Every home was visited. When the girls in ecstasy came to a house where someone was sick in bed, they would kneel and pray and offer the crucifix to the sick person. If they came to a home of a widow, they would recite prayers before a picture of the deceased or make the sign of the cross on the pillow of the vacated bed. They would also go to the cemetery and extend the crucifix through the bars of the gate. In this little Spanish mountain village, events of the greatest significance were unfolding. Although no one realized it at the time, the Blessed Virgin Mary was preparing us for the storm that was about to break upon the church. She had come to personally reaffirm all the church holds and teaches. Everything Mary did with the young girls was infused with meaning for all Christians. While in ecstasy, they prayed in every position, kneeling, standing, sitting, walking, or lying down. The Virgin was reminding us that we can always be with God and her, no matter where we are or what we're doing. Our Lord and our Heavenly Mother want to be part of all our actions, whether we're working at home, at our jobs, or driving a car. When taxis that brought people up to Garabandal were parked in the village, the girls in ecstasy went with their crucifixes and traced the sign of the cross on the windshields. Nothing was too insignificant for the Virgin. "She's even interested in our cows," said Mary lowly after one ecstasy. Through the children, Mary taught us how we should act toward our neighbor. If one of the girls' shoes fell off while they were walking in ecstasy over the rugged terrain, the Virgin would require that another girl put the shoe on the foot of her friend. Sometimes, as two girls marched through the village together, they would separate, each taking a different route, but both remaining in ecstasy. When they came together again at a different point, they would embrace. Whenever they walked together in ecstasy, they were always arm in arm or holding hands. And just who was this Lady of Light acting in such a powerful way in the little mountain hamlet of Garabandal? Those who never fully understood her role only had to look at the figure on the cross that she commanded the girls to present to the onlookers. She was the Mother of Christ with only one desire: to lead everyone to her Son Jesus, the Savior of all mankind. Was Mary only the Blessed Mother of Catholics? At one point, Conchita was approached by a Protestant. He wanted to know if he could kiss the crucifix. The next time she offered it for veneration while in ecstasy. Conchita was raised in a totally Catholic environment. She was concerned about this request and mentioned it to the Virgin when she appeared. Mary looked at the man and said, "He too is my son." And operating as she did through the young girl, caused the crucifix to be brought to the man's lips. For the girls, all that they were experiencing must have seemed like a foretaste of heaven. But heaven was not yet. The children, like the rest of us, still had to live in the real world, a world getting progressively worse with each passing day. June 19th and 20th, 1962, would be two nights not easily forgotten in the annals of Garabandal. The children in ecstasy were heard screaming in terror. The veil was lifted, and they were permitted a glimpse of future events. They saw turmoil everywhere, with the church being persecuted in a world dominated by communism. Just as things were at their worst, they were told that a supernatural warning would be sent by God that would be seen and felt by everyone on earth. Then, even though they were in the presence of the Blessed Virgin, they became terrified as they saw scenes of the future chastisement that God would send if the world did not change after the warning and miracle. Although some distance from the girls, as the Virgin had requested, the villagers who were there, and that meant just about everybody, were so shaken by the girls' cries that on the following day, the whole town went to confession and communion. For some time, the girls pleaded with the Blessed Virgin and Saint Michael to perform a miracle to convince those who still did not believe. Finally, Saint Michael told Conchita that on a certain date indicated by the Virgin, the invisible communion which he had been giving her would on that day become visible on her tongue. Conchita called that a small miracle because she thought the host could always be seen by the onlookers whenever she received it. When the day arrived that had been announced by Conchita 15 days in advance, several hundred people were in the village, but the wait proved long and tiresome. Many became discouraged and left. Then about 1:30 in the morning of the 19th, Conchita came out of her house in ecstasy, turned a corner, and as the crowd pressed around her, dropped to her knees in an adjacent street. She then put out her tongue. Those just inches away affirmed that it was bare. Suddenly, faster than the human eye could detect, a brilliant white host appeared on the girl's tongue. A Barcelona businessman with a borrowed movie camera and only flashlight illumination took several frames of film showing the host on Conchita's tongue. Here was a miracle announced in advance, realized and then recorded on film to serve as proof of the authenticity of the Garabandal events. In October of 1962, 900 miles from Garabandal, another event was unfolding that would cause reverberations within the church unprecedented in modern times. Pope John the 23rd had just opened the Second Vatican Council. A natural question arose. Was there any relationship between this monumental ecclesiastical event and the remarkable happenings taking place in the tiny mountain village of northern Spain? The answer is an unqualified yes. But only in the future will the full significance of that relationship be known. In ecstasy, Conchita was heard repeating the words of the Virgin. The council will be the greatest of all. It will be a success. That's good. So they will know you better, and you will be more pleased. By January of 1963, the visions had ceased for Mary Lowley, Jacinta, and Mary Cruz. Only Conchita continued to have visions, but they were fewer and farther apart. However, at this time, Conchita and Mary Lowley began to experience locutions. A locution is an interior voice without any accompanying vision. In 1947, Joey Lomangino lost his sight and sense of smell in a freak accident that severed his optic and olfactory nerves. After a long and painful period of readjustment, he emerged in 1961 as a successful businessman, but greatly tired from overwork. His doctor suggested that he take a European vacation. So he left his home in Lindenhurst, New York, with relatives, to visit his uncle in southern Italy. Joey was not very religious at the time, and due only to his uncle's persistence, did he consent to a long automobile ride that ended in San Giovanni Rotondo, where the stigmatist Padre Pio lived. This Franciscan friar, with the wounds of Christ in his hands, feet, and side, was revered as a living saint. But Joey didn't anticipate any personal encounter. After the Mass was over, he found himself in a room with some other men to receive the Padre's blessing as he passed by.
As Father Pio came into the room, we all knelt down and received his blessing. And Father Pio was coming from the left-hand side of the room across the front. And all of a sudden I heard the moving of knees and all, and I didn't know what was going on. And Father Pio had his arms around me, and he started to kiss me on the forehead, and he said, Joey, he said, I'm so happy to see you. And my uncle told me that it was Father Pio embracing me, and I was at a loss for words because I was almost the last one up there, and nobody knew I was going, not even myself. I knew I was going to Father Pio.
Joey was deeply impressed, and 2 years later returned to San Giovanni. This time he decided to go to confession to Padre Pio.
I went into Father Pio, into the confessional, and I knelt down on the kneeling bench, and Father Pio was sitting right in front of me. And he took me by the hand like that, and I was shocked because I thought of the American confessional, you know, with the panel. See? So when I knelt down and Father Pio had me by the hand, he told me in Italian, he says, Joey, confess yourself. And to be very honest with you, I was embarrassed because I wasn't leading the right life. And I was just flabbergasted. I didn't know just what to say. So Father Pio took me by the hand like that, and he tells me in Italian, he says, confess yourself. And again, I just found it very difficult to speak to him. And then in perfect English, he said to me, Joey, he says, do you remember when you were in a bar with a woman named Barbara? Do you remember the sins you committed? Then in perfect English, he went right down the line and telling me the people I was with, the places I was at, and the sins I committed. And of course, I was perspiring, and but I had the grace by God to realize that if I had to endure all of that, to get back to being happy, it was worth it. And I really believed that Father Pio could help me. So, of course, when he came to the bottom of all my sins, and it felt to me like 1,000 years, he said to me in Italian, he says, are you sorry? And I says, yes, I am, Father Pio. He gave me absolution for my sins. My eyes started to roll in my head. I started to rub my eyes like this, and my head was going around. I kept rubbing my eyes, and my head kept going around. And then all of a sudden, my mind became very, very clear. And he put up a stigmata hand like this to my lips. I kissed the stigmata, and then he gave me a little smack in the face. And he tells me in Italian, Joey, a little patience and a little courage, and you're going to be all right. I was 33 years old, and I felt like I was 16. I had a firm purpose of amendment. I was sorry for all the sins I committed in my life. And I felt so good and so clean that I just didn't want to get involved with anybody because I was afraid by talking, I was going to lose the grace that I received.
But there was still another grace in store for Joey as he again knelt with the other men to receive Padre Pio's blessing.
When I had my injury up here in 1947, I lost my sense of smell. And this has been all stitched up, and this is a 3-inch fracture across the top. I not only lost my eyes, but I lost my sense of smell. So when I knelt down to receive Father Pio's blessing, I got the fragrance of rose that comes from the blood in his hands. And when I got that fragrance, I was startled, and I went against the wall with my arms up like this to protect myself. I didn't know what it was. So Father Pio pulled down my hand, and he told me in Italian, Joey, don't be afraid. And he touched me like this at the bridge of my nose, and my sense of smell was restored to me after being without it from the day of my accident in June 1947, which was 16 years.
Joey was overwhelmed with peace and joy and did not want to leave San Giovanni. However, his traveling companion reminded him of their prearranged agreement to spend part of their vacation in a place called Garabandal.
When Mario reminded me that we have to leave and go to Garabandal, I said, Mario, how do we know it's true? Maybe it's not a true apparition, and maybe it's a trick of the devil to make me lose the graces that I just received. I says, let's go ask Father Pio. So he said, okay. So, of course, we were always given wonderful, wonderful reception by the priest at Father Pio's. And we went to him, we said, I'd like to speak to Father Pio, is that okay? He said, oh yes, Joe. So he made arrangements, and we came back again that day, and we greeted Father Pio in the cloister. When I knelt down, I said to Father Pio, Father Pio, is it true that the Virgin is appearing to the four girls of Garabandal? And he said, yes. And I said, Father Pio, should I go there? He said, yes, why not? And that's how it happened. Because I received the assurance from Father Pio that the Virgin was appearing and that he permitted me to go, then I wasn't afraid, and I went.
February 1963 would mark the first of many visits to Garabandal for Joey Lomangino. In those days, especially during the winter months, one of the only ways to get up to the village over the winding mountain road was by ox cart. Joey was not long in the village before he met the children to whom the Virgin had appeared. He was immediately impressed by their simplicity and sincerity. Conchita was to become his close friend. Joey was also impressed by the message and the need to make it known, but felt handicapped by his affliction.
I said to myself, what can I do to make the knowledge of Father Pio and Garabandal better known in the world? What can I do? What can a blind guy do? I was never even in a school play. That's how shy I was.
Joey returned home. He had a scrapbook made up of pictures of Padre Pio and the Garabandal girls in ecstasy, with captions underneath in Braille. He then went around to the homes of friends and relatives, explaining about the famed stigmatist and the remarkable happenings taking place in Garabandal. From this small seed would grow a worldwide apostolate. At the beginning of June 1963, Conchita stunned her listeners with the prophecy that after Pope John the 23rd, there would be only three more popes, and then it will be the end of our times, but not the end of the world. On March 19th, 1964, the Feast of St. Joseph, Conchita had a locution at the Pines, in which the Virgin told her that on the day of the great miracle, Joey Lomangino will regain his eyesight and will see permanently. On July 18th, 1964, Conchita had another locution in which he was told that on the day after the great miracle, the body of Father Luis Andreo will be found incorrupt in his grave. January of 1965 opened for Conchita with a two-hour ecstasy at the Pines, in which the Virgin revealed the nature of the warning to be sent by God to purify the world in anticipation of the great miracle to follow. She also told Conchita that because the world had not responded to her first message, she would give a second and last one on June 18th, 1965, through the intercession of Saint Michael. Let us now take a look at the great prophesied events of Garabandal. First will come the warning. It will be seen in the sky and then felt interiorly by everyone on earth. No one will escape it. At a moment in the not too distant future, when the world is in the midst of a great turmoil, everything will be held in suspension. At that moment, everyone will see the wrong they have done and the good they have failed to do. It will be extremely painful. People would prefer to die rather than go through it, but it will cause no physical harm. If a person should die, it will only be from the shock of the experience. The warning will serve as a purification to correct the conscience of the world and prepare it for the great miracle. The miracle will take place at the Grove of the Nine Pine Trees. It will occur on a Thursday evening at 8:30, on or between the 8th and the 16th of March, April, or May. Conchita knows the date and will announce it 8 days in advance. It will be on the feast day of a martyr of the Eucharist and will coincide with a great ecclesiastical event in the church. All those either in the village or on the surrounding mountains will see it. The sick who are present will be cured. Sinners will be converted, and the incredulous will believe. It will be the greatest miracle that Jesus will have ever performed for the world. As a result of the miracle, Russia will be converted. After the miracle, a permanent, visible, supernatural sign will remain at the Pines until the end of time. If, after the miracle, the world still does not change, then God will send the chastisement. It will be far worse than anything man could bring upon himself. It will be in keeping with what he deserves for his crimes. On June 18th, 1965, thousands of people filled the tiny village of Garabandal to witness Conchita's ecstasy and hear the Virgin's second and final message. Once again, the crowd would have to wait. Late at night, Conchita went into ecstasy. She held out the cross for three people to kiss. Saint Michael then gave her the Blessed Virgin's second and final message. As my message of October 18th has not been complied with and has not been made known to the world, I am advising you that this is the last one. Before, the cup was filling up. Now, it is flowing over. Many cardinals, many bishops, and many priests are on the road to perdition and are taking many souls with them. Less and less importance is being given to the Eucharist. You should turn the wrath of God away from yourselves by your efforts. If you ask his forgiveness with sincere hearts, he will pardon you. I, your mother, through the intercession of Saint Michael the Archangel, ask you to amend your lives. You are now receiving the last warnings. I love you very much and do not want your condemnation. Pray to us with sincerity and we will grant your requests. You should make more sacrifices. Think about the passion of Jesus. November 13th, 1965 was a day mixed with joy and sadness for Conchita. The Virgin appeared with her child to the teenager, but it was to be for the last time at Garabandal. As Mary had already indicated, this was to be a special apparition for kissing religious objects, and Conchita had many with her. After kissing the articles, the Virgin said, "Through the kiss I have bestowed on these objects, my son will perform prodigies. Distribute them to others. Talk to me, Conchita. Talk to me about my children. I hold them all beneath my mantle. This will be the last time you will see me here, but I shall always be with you and with all my children. Conchita, why don't you go and visit my son in the tabernacle? He waits for you night and day." Conchita said to the Virgin, "I am so happy when I see both of you. Why don't you take me now to heaven with you?" She replied, "Remember what I told you on your patronal feast day. When you present yourself before God, your hands must be filled with good deeds done for your brothers and for his glory. At the present time, your hands are empty." It was all over. The happy moments when Conchita had been with her heavenly mother and the child Jesus had passed. Although she still felt their presence, she said, "They have left my soul filled with peace and joy and a great desire to overcome my faults and to love with all my strength the hearts of Jesus and Mary, who love us so much." What the Blessed Virgin said about the kissed objects has come true. Cases of physical cures and other favors continue to be reported from different parts of the world. Many have come from a medal that Conchita gave to Joey Lomangino. It's been venerated by thousands of people the world over during Joey's many years of apostolic activity. And what does medical science have to say about the Garabandal events? More than 40 doctors examined the girls at different times. Pediatrician Dr. Celestino Ortiz studied them for 22 consecutive days. Outside of ecstasy, he found them to be normal and well-balanced. And of their ecstasies, he said, to keep silent would be true scientific cowardice. We do not find any convincing explanation for such phenomena. Dr. Ricardo Punzernau was internationally known as a neuropsychiatrist right at the top of his profession. He performed the most extensive tests on the girls over a 12-day period. His conclusions? The quantity and the quality of the phenomena ruled out any natural explanation. He said, from a strictly scientific point of view, one cannot deny the possibility of a supernatural cause in all these phenomena. Another prominent psychiatrist connected with the events is Dr. Luis Morales. In 1961, he had his own clinic in Santander, and the bishop appointed him chief medical examiner of a commission formed to study the reported apparitions. At the time, he did not believe the events to be of supernatural origin. Later, this same Dr. Morales made headlines when he reversed his original position. On May 30th, 1983, he gave a public lecture with the bishop's permission in Santander's largest conference hall. To the overflow crowd, he gave his reasons why he believed the Garabandal apparitions were genuine. From the earliest days of the apparitions, the girls wanted to enter the religious life, but it was not to be. While attending the boarding school of the Carmelite missionaries in Pamplona, Conchita had a locution with Jesus. He told her it was not his desire that she become a religious, but that she stay in the world to speak about Mary. Today, all four visionaries are married. Conchita, Mary Loli, and Jacinta are married to Americans and live in the United States. Mary Cruz remained in Spain, and in 1971 married Ignacio Caballero. They now live in Aviles and have four children. In 1973, Conchita married Patrick Keener of New York, where they now live with their four children. In 1974, Mary Loli married Francis Lafleur of Massachusetts. They have three children. In 1976, Jacinta married U.S. Navy man Jeffrey Moynihan of California. They now have a daughter. In 1977, Joey Lomangino, at the age of 47, surprised everyone in the Garabandal apostolate when he married Marilyn Luther of Michigan. They now have two sons, Joseph and John. The Blessed Virgin's main purpose in appearing at Garabandal was to deliver a message. But besides this twofold message, such strong emphasis was given to certain subjects that they carried a message of their own. The overriding importance of the Holy Eucharist was emphasized by Saint Michael giving the girls invisible communion and the miracle of the visible host, as well as their many visits to the Blessed Sacrament. It was noticed during these visits that the girls never turned their backs to the tabernacle, even going so far as to walk out of the church backwards. During the entire length of the events, the girls were constantly urged by the Virgin to pray for priests. The Virgin chose to appear at Garabandal as Our Lady of Mount Carmel, a title closely connected with the brown scapular. She spoke of its importance and wore it on her wrist during the apparitions. The scapular is a sign of consecration to the Blessed Mother. Those who wear it with faith and devotion can be sure of her maternal protection in the terrible days in which we live. The rosary was an important feature of the Garabandal events. Mary didn't ask the girls to recite it during the apparitions. She commanded them. She first taught them the mysteries and how to say the prayers slowly, thinking about the words. Once they learned it properly, she only joined in at the Glory Be. The significance of sacramentals, such as crucifixes, rosaries, medals, and wedding rings, was dramatized by the Virgin's desire to kiss them and impart to them special powers of healing and conversion. The message of Garabandal is heaven's solution to the crises of today. Now it is up to us. How we respond will determine the future of our generation.
See the Blessed Mother, she has so much light. We don't see nothing around us. We don't know, we don't feel where we are. Then all the time we look up to her.
And she spoke to you?
Yeah, she spoke to us. To me, I feel when I see her, it's like it's one friend you see for so long. She talk to us right away. She say, "Hi, Conchita." And she say,
"Hi, Conchita?"
Yeah, in Spanish, you know, "Hola, Conchita." And she talked to all the girls, and then we talk about everything happened to us, and from the time we see the angels, we tell her everything we do in the farm, you know, like...
Were you frightened?
No, I tell you, it's like we see one Godfrey and we don't see for so long. It's better I say it's like my mother. I don't see for so long, like I feel like I know her before. The Blessed Mother gave us the message the July 4th, and she said to us, give it you October. The first message is, I don't say in Spanish, but I can say in English. Hay que hacer muchos sacrificios, mucha penitencia, visitar al Santísimo con frecuencia, pero antes tenemos que ser muy buenos. Ya se está llenando la copa, y si no cambiamos, tendrá un castigo muy grande. This is the first message. Can be all over in the world, you can be any place, you can be, you know, in the aeroplane, so you can feel that aviso, can be direct from God. No man can do it on any explanation, human way, you can explain how, you know, the visa. And you can feel inside you, and you can see with your eyes. But they don't go hurt you.
It's not going to hurt you?
No. Like, to me, it's like two stars, what you call, crash.
Yes.
Like two stars, and it's crash, they make a lot of noise, a lot of light, but they don't fall down. You know, the thing, they don't hear us, but we're going to see it. In that moment, we're going to see our conscience. You're going to see what everything wrong you see, you do it.
You're going to see everything wrong that
yeah.
you're doing.
And you're going to see everything good you don't do it.
Everything good that you're not doing.
Yeah. The miracle Qigong sent to us, the purpose is to leave us know the message she tell us is what she wanna be done. That she wanna save us. That she think we will see the miracle, then we're gonna change our lives.
So it's to tell people that the message is true?
Yes, all the message.
What can you tell us about the big miracle?
Well, the only thing I can tell gonna be in my village, the miracle. Cause something gonna happen in my village.
In Garabandal?
Yes, everybody is there around the village can see it. The people sick gonna be there, gonna be cured. The Blessed Mother said, los enfermos sanarán. The sinners gonna be converted. And then after that day, gonna be one sign in the pines. It's gonna be like
it's going to be a sign where?
In the pines.
In the pine trees.
Yes, in the pine trees. We see the Blessed Mother in the pine trees a lot of time. And she said, gonna be one sign there. And she tell us the sign gonna be, it's gonna be there forever. Like, for example, this dog gonna be there, but like it, like maybe the rayo del sol. Something we can see is only from God, gonna be there forever.
Do you know what sort of sign?
I know the sign, but I don't know, I can explain. I know you can see it, you can take pictures, but you can touch, you can't palpar.
Feel it?
You can feel it.
So it's like a bright light?
Yes, something like that. And it gonna be there forever.
That sign will stay there?
Yeah, forever.
And this big miracle, do you know when it's going to happen?
Yes, I know the year is going to be happening, I know the day, but the Blessed Mother said tell 8 days before.
So, you know the date for the miracle?
Yeah.
8 days before it?
I don't tell to everybody.
You'll tell everybody?
Yes.
If the miracle doesn't come...
I hope that this won't happen. Now I'm coming.
But today, yeah. You believe it will come?
Yes, I believe very strongly it's coming. No, I never, I think, tell.
And you believe that your visions of the Virgin Mary were true?
I believe I see the Blessed Mother, and I believe I see the angel. Then, it's the Pope is coming and say, no, you don't see the Blessed Mother, this is not the Blessed Mother. Then I say, you know, I see the lady, beautiful lady. I see a beautiful angel, look like an angel.
You know, don't you, that many people have delusions. They imagine
yes.
that they see things.
Yeah.
Do you sometimes worry that maybe you have had a delusion?
I don't worry about that. Before I worry when that doubt. But then we had the doctor, they do all kind of the studying in us. You know,
they studied you?
Yeah. They say we are normal.
They say you're normal?
Yeah.
When you look at your little children and you look ahead to the future, are you frightened for them?
Yes, I do. Even a lot of time I say, I can't take my children to heaven. I won't miss them, but I like miss them. Take the comes. I think they're going to suffer.
You think they're going to suffer?
Yes.
Why?
But I believe after the miracle, all this thing, we're going to change our lives. But we are, I think we lost a lot of, like, the same other thing. We lost like a lot of the same of the sing, a sing no more, you know, like we got to spoil, we don't do sacrifice.
You mean we've lost a sense of sin?
Yes.
Yes.
It's very hard to, you know, to start all over again, even to teach them to children. Like I see the way they're teaching to children now, it's no sin no more. It's,
no sin?
Yeah. Like I believe we're going to get the punishment.
You do think the punishment's going to come?
Yeah. If the punishment coming, I am sure going to, you know, get my children.
It's going to get your
in
children?
In my children's life.
In your children's lifetime?
Yeah.
And that worries you?
Sure, worries me. Yeah.
Can you help them to be saved from the punishment?
The only thing I can do is the best thing we can do is, you know, teaching the babies the best to love God, the Blessed Mother, have strong faith in Jesus.
And what now do you want for the rest of your life?
Love God. I do His will.